Good morning and welcome to this, our worship service coming to you from Trinity Lutheran Church here in Frankfurt, Germany. I'm Pastor Gary Schuske, and it's my privilege to welcome all of you to this, the last weekend before we arrive at Holy Week. Palm Sunday is next week already. We want to take a moment to especially say welcome to all of you who are joining us from the greater Rhine-Main area of Germany, and also all of you who continue to join us from all around the world. We're so glad that you are joining us as we continue this Lenten journey together. Just a few thoughts about worshiping from a distance, if maybe you're joining us for the first time. First of all, we want to encourage you to establish a worship area in your home. There, by your television or by your computer monitor, draw up some chairs. Light a candle or two, reminding us of the light of the world. And maybe there's a child in your home that would love to be your acolyte for the day. Please go ahead and arrange that. We do ask you to refrain from having flowers or plants. Wait until the joy of Easter morning to have those as part of your celebration. Have your Bible nearby, maybe also a pen or pencil so you can jot some things down along the way. Please do turn off your cell phones and so forth. And then finally, in the service, do all the things we would do here in church. Sit and stand and sing and pray and reflect on all those parts of the worship. As today we remember, divine service means that God is serving us in all of these things. If you'd like to pause the video for a moment then to prepare a few things, you're welcome to do so. Otherwise, we're going to take just a moment here in church in silence as we move from our time of instruction to our time of worship. We begin this morning then with our prelude, Come to Calvary's Holy Mountain. Stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the word, in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. Almighty God, by your great goodness, mercifully look upon your people, that we may be governed and preserved evermore in body and soul. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated now for our Old Testament reading.
The Old Testament reading is from the 31st chapter of Jeremiah, starting at the 31st verse. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each or his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We now have our epistle reading.
The epistle reading is from the 5th chapter of Hebrews, starting at the 1st verse. For every high priest chosen from among men is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He can deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obliged to offer sacrifice for his own sin, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes his honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, You are my son, today I have begotten you. He says also in another place, You are a priest forever, after the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered us prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger. Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them, and they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. And taking the 12 again, he began to teach them what was to happen to him, saying, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles. And they will mock him and spit on him and flog him and kill him. And after 3 days he will rise." And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" And they said to him, "We are able." And Jesus said to them, "That the cup I drink, you will drink, and the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, for it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John. And Jesus called them to him and said to them, "You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We now have our sermon hymn, "My Song is Love Unknown." Mercy and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. Our text for this, the last Sunday in the season of Lent, Palm Sunday coming now next week, is the gospel reading from Mark, the 10th chapter, read a few moments ago. Have you ever heard words, maybe news, that you just didn't want to hear? Dear friends, I know that's happened to all of us. And something else I know for sure, some news is harder to hear than others, isn't it? Now, before we go any further, I want to be clear. The goal of our message today is not to make light of any news you've heard. Maybe it's news that's touched your life in some way that might not seem as important to someone else. But the truth is, there is some news that's harder to hear. For example, maybe the news is simple. You're simply being asked to listen to someone's life story again. Maybe the news you heard is it's going to rain on the picnic. Maybe you heard the news that your favorite team didn't win the big match. You heard the news there was some kind of traffic accident. Thank God nobody was hurt, but everybody's going to be late to work. Or maybe you heard that dreaded news that your flight has been delayed or canceled and what that might look like for your day or for your week. Other news, though, is harder to hear. Maybe you heard that you didn't pass the test. You didn't get the scholarship. You didn't get the job. You didn't get the promotion. Still other news is harder yet to hear. Maybe you heard the news of some kind of test results from the doctor, some sort of diagnosis for you or for someone that you love that was just not good news. Certainly in this last year, we've had the news again and again as we try to ponder the pandemic numbers around the world, and somewhere in the back of our heart to remember every number is not a number, but a real person, a real family that has dealt with this very real pandemic and all that it means for us, from lockdown to economics to what it's doing to our relationships. It's very hard to hear about, isn't it? Dear friends, the truth is that some news is harder to hear, but this is my question for you and for me today. When you hear news that you do not want to hear, how do you react? What do you do? Because that question on our heart helps to bring us now into our gospel from Mark chapter 10 this morning. It starts out this way. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. By the way, does that sound familiar? Of course it does. In some ways, that's sort of a summary of the season of Lent, isn't it? Listen closely. Jesus on his way into Jerusalem, and notice what's happening. Jesus is taking the lead. Don't forget, Jesus can already see the cross. He can already see why he's traveling to that cross, because he can see your face and mine. And yet, where is Jesus? Jesus is taking the lead. You might say Jesus is determined. Also in this scene, there are the disciples. The Bible tells us they were amazed. Maybe amazed at some of the things Jesus taught them right before this passage. Still others in a crowd are following, and they, the Bible tells us, are afraid. Think of that. Determined, amazed, afraid, and all of that there in the presence of Jesus Christ. That's a pretty good summary sometimes of the human condition, I think. Maybe it's something that you're feeling right now, some fear, some amazement, maybe some determination along the way. Whatever it is and how you respond, listen to what Jesus says next. He says, "We are going to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man," which happens to be Jesus' favorite title for himself, "the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and to the scribes." That's not all. He will be condemned by them, and they will deliver him over to the Gentiles, that is, to the Romans. In other words, the Israelite leaders, the religious leaders, are going to hand one of their own over to the enemy. Can you believe it? Still, Jesus isn't done. He says he will be mocked, he will be spit upon, he will be flogged, he will be killed. Oh, and don't forget the last thing he says, and 3 days later, he will rise again. Talk about news that amazes, news that makes us frightened, news that can even make us feel confused, my friends. Whatever you are feeling, how does it make you react? One thing is for certain, I hope you don't react like James and John do in this passage. Don't forget, this is James and John, as in Peter, James, and John, the very ones who got to go to the top of the Mountain of Transfiguration. There they've seen the fullness of Jesus' glory. Now he is telling them of the fullness of the horror that he is going to endure. And what do they say? Teacher, we want you to give us whatever we ask of you. Are you kidding? Were they listening at all? My friends, I say this often. Sometimes as I read my Bible, I think what a good thing it is that you're not Jesus and I'm not Jesus, because if I were, and I heard my disciples say what they just said, I'd probably reach for a convenient lightning bolt and be done with them once and for all. But that's not what our gracious Jesus does. Can you believe what he says? Into the middle of their selfishness, he says, "What is it that you would like me to do for you?" Dear friends, before we start thinking too little of those disciples, realize that we do that all the time. Maybe right now you're sitting in church, you're sitting at a monitor at home, and you're following along with the service, and you heard what Jesus just said, and yet somehow in the back of your mind right now are the things you would like Jesus to do for you. Or maybe the things you're frustrated that he hasn't done for you lately, and all of a sudden, are we really listening? My friends, we all know what we want, at least some of the time. We want things from our family. We want things from our spouse. We want things from our children. We want things from our colleague. We want things from our boss. Why, we even want things from our church. The question is, what if? What if your wife or husband, what if your child, your neighbor, your colleague, your boss, what if they don't do the things the way that you want them to do? How do you respond? Do you respond in anger? Maybe in silence? Maybe with a grudge you're going to carry until they finally come around to doing things your way? And what about the church? Every one of us has ideas, don't we, of what the church should teach and preach and act and think? And what if it isn't being done the way that you want? How do you begin to feel? What do you begin to do? And now think about all of those things, the things you want from family, friends, from your church. If you don't get it, how does that make you respond or think about God? Does it want you to make you think in God-pleasing ways, or maybe not so much? Still, we're not done. Jesus says to James and John, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And can you believe it? They say, "Lord, in your kingdom, in your glory, can we have the seat on your left and on your right?" To put it another way, can we be number two and number three persons in your kingdom? What they want is power, prestige, glory. To put it another way, what they really want is control. And We all know how that feels as well. Every one of us, somewhere in the back of our heart, does want a bit more power, maybe a bit more prestige, a bit more glory or appreciation, and certainly we all want a little bit more control. I wonder if at this very moment you're thinking, that's not a very good description of me, you're thinking, because you don't like the limelight, and maybe you don't. But I would ask you to search your heart. What is it that you must control in your life? Maybe think about it this way. Well, I'm not getting this, and no one's given me that, whatever it might be, so I am going to hold on and control this thing. Only you know what that might be. Into the call of those disciples for prestige and for control, into our desire for those things also, Jesus says this: you do not know what you are asking. Can you drink the cup that I will drink? Can you be baptized with the baptism I will go through? And they actually answer, yes. But they don't understand, and neither do we. The cup, especially in the Old Testament, in Isaiah, refers to the cup of God's wrath. So often in the Bible, baptism applies to some sort of trial, like a fiery trial, a baptism of fire, something that we must go through. Jesus is simply asking this: can you go through those things? Or to ask it another way, as he asks us as well, can you save yourself? Will you be fine on your own? And the answer is simple: no. So, I guess we're going to have to depend on Jesus completely after all. That's what Jesus promises us in this gospel. What does he say? The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Keep your eyes on Jesus and watch what he does. Sure enough, our determined, our resolute Jesus is right there out front, traveling into Jerusalem. He can already see the cross, and he can already see the reason he's going to the cross. Why is that? Dear friends, it's because of the person that you see, that I see in the mirror every day. That's how much he loves us. Into Jerusalem he goes. Finally, he goes to the upper room. There he has a Last Supper that we now know as the Lord's Supper. But watch closely. Even before the meal is over, one of his closest friends begins to slip away. Why? Because he's going to do exactly what Jesus said he would do: deliver him over to the chief priests and the scribes. Shortly thereafter, they go to a garden. What does Jesus pray? My God, if it were possible, take this cup from me. But not my will, but thy will be done. Right after that, Jesus is arrested and finally delivered over to those Gentiles, to the enemy, you might say, by his very own people. What comes next? Jesus tells us that, but don't forget, what happens next is not just done by the Romans, it's done by the very people he came to save, who mock him, who spit on him. Finally, he is flogged and then placed on a cross. There on the cross, Jesus endures the cup of the wrath of God, which should be ours. There on the cross is Jesus' baptism. You might say a baptism by fire, an ordeal that goes on for hours and hours beyond anything that we can understand, until finally Jesus, yes indeed, is killed. His body then was taken down and placed in a tomb. Remember, Joseph of Arimathea and our good friend Nicodemus from last week were there. The next thing also comes true. Jesus promised back then, he promises us again today. It's why we have the festival of Easter. It's not all about bonnets and the trapping and the flowers and good gatherings and good food. No, it's about the simple fact that some frightened women gathered by the tomb and looked in and he was not there. And the angel said, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen, just as he told you." Jesus has taken our cup. Jesus has taken our baptism, and now he takes away the penalty. He's paid the ransom for the bondage of our sin, and he does it in these words we hear week after week: "Your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." In that forgiveness, what does Jesus do? He gives us the benefit of all he endured, that baptism he speaks of, and now he gives us a baptism of life-giving water that saves us, that claims us to be his own, that sustains us every moment until we see him face to face. And the cup of wrath, that is now replaced with another cup. A cup that is the very blood of Jesus Christ along with the very body of Jesus Christ. Why? For the forgiveness of our sins, for the strengthening of our faith, to save us. Today we want to stop and ponder our gracious Jesus who does all of these things for us. A few moments ago we sang these beautiful words. Listen to them again for a moment. How do we respond to what Jesus has done for us? The hymn says, "Here might I stay and sing." No story so divine. Never was love, dear King, never was grief like thine. This is my friend, in whose sweet praise I all my days could gladly spend. Dear friends, think about that for a moment. Especially now in a time when we're not able to sing together, how can we sing our responses to God? And I think there is a wonderful answer in this passage. Every week now, I remind you the importance of spending time with God in the Word, spending time with God in prayer. By the way, please plan to join us this Wednesday for our midweek devotion. That will be the topic of our devotion. But today I want to give you one more. How can we sing our praises to God? I read a great story this week about a man who said this. He said, every year his family visits the beautiful American city of Santa Fe, New Mexico in the U.S. I've been there myself. If you ever get the chance, don't miss it. What a beautiful place to visit. He said, though, what I love especially is going to midweek services at a local church there, and here is why. Because when you walk in the door of that church and there's only one way in, there's a great big sign that says, "Servants' Entrance." Dear friends, I love that story, but I would round it out a bit for us. Remember, as we come in the door of worship, why do we call this divine service? We call it divine service because here is what God does for us, what we cannot do for ourselves. In our worship, we hear that word of salvation. But then what does he do? He sends us back out into this world to people he loves. So I'd like you to imagine in your own home, and we're going to imagine also on the door to the Gemeinde House here in Trinity Sanctuary, imagine that's the door that had the sign that says, "Servants' Entrance." Because what are we doing? We're entering the field where God calls us to serve every day. As the season of Lent continues into Holy Week, I ask you to prayerfully consider, first of all, what are some ways that God has called you to serve? And by the way, they may not be very glorious. It may simply be the day-to-day task of taking care of small children or taking care of the work you do for daily bread. But it I'd also like you to pray about one more thing, maybe some special new area of service, some kind of service that could continue to bless someone in these days of pandemic and lockdown that go on. Maybe there's a new way that you could serve. Maybe it's not crowds. Maybe it's just one person. And as you think about going out that door that says servant's entrance, stop and reflect on what Jesus has done for you. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And he did give his life as a ransom for us all. In his name, amen. Now may the peace that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand now as we join together, confessing our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We now go to God in prayer, and as we do each week, we'll make sure to add some time as well for you to raise the prayers of your own hearts and minds today. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, in these Lenten days, we ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. Write your word on our hearts that we might know you, your grace, and your forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, bless and sustain your church all around the world. Be with all those who lead, preach, teach, translate, and serve in every way. Work in and through us that we might speak your saving word of truth and show your fervent love for all people. We pray for our mission partners in the U.S. and all around the world. For the pastors and people of Family of Christ Lutheran Church, North Tampa, Florida, River Cliff Lutheran Church, Sandy Springs, Georgia, Faith Lutheran Church, Eustace, Florida, at the Sloka Lutheran Church, Sloka, Latvia, we also ask your blessing upon all those who take part in the work of Mission Central. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, your Son came not to be served, but to serve. Help us not lord our authority over one another, but humbly serve one another in our homes, our communities, and our congregation as Christ so humbly served us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, look in mercy on all those to whom you have given earthly authority. Guard them from the temptation to lord it over us improperly, that they might faithfully serve according to your good and gracious will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you that you watch over, protect, and defend us through the service of others. Bless, we pray, the men and women who served in armed forces all around the world, especially those far from home or in areas of danger. Bless also those who serve us as police, firefighters, first responders, and all emergency services. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, you took the cup of suffering that should have been ours. In your saving grace, we find comfort today and every day. We ask that you would bless, sustain, and give relief to all those who are sick, suffering, or in any need. We pray for those who are dealing with coronavirus in our way today. Be with the sick, those who have lost loved ones, those who work every day to keep us healthy. And Lord, we pray that you would deliver us from the bondage of this pandemic. We also pray for those requesting our prayers today, for Al and Kathleen and their family, Rachel and her child, for Hans Ulrich, for Marlene, Edgar, Susanna, Karen, Eddie, Myra, Stephen and his family, Andreas and his family, Pat, Beth, Christina, Karen, John and Irene, Pat and Glenn, Jakob, Jan, Johanna, Katrine and her family, Jagadish, Satish, John and Debbie, Donette, Glenn and their family, Kent and Noriko and their family. We also ask your blessing on Reverend Brent and Jennifer and their family. Be with them in all the days ahead. Heavenly Father, we now take a moment to raise before you those in our own hearts and minds. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things, whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We now take a moment to share the peace of the Lord with one another. Please do so in your home with a smile and a hug, and we do so with a wave here in church. Peace of the Lord be with you all. Peace of the Lord, peace of the Lord, peace of the Lord, peace of the Lord. Dear friends, let's now take a few moments in our offering reflection. As we do that, we want to remind you, please, to consider online forms of giving. You'll find that information on the homepage of our website, continuing to allow us to do ministry here in Rhein-Main and out into the world. But also during the time of reflection, please do think about the many blessings that God has given you, maybe to think about someone that has served you faithfully in whatever way, and also thank God for the chance he gives you to serve others. We do that now in a moment of silence. Please pray with me. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us, that we may be a blessing to others. Amen. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. We now have our closing hymn, Let Us Ever Walk with Jesus.
Thank you.
For our dismissal, just a few words of announcement as we approach Holy Week now. First of all, a simple reminder of some dates and times. The Women's Bible Study will be continuing on Monday evenings. That is at 7 p.m. That's taking place on Zoom. All you need to do is contact the church office and we'll make sure to get you connected to that, beginning a new study this week. It's a great time to step in, just in time for Holy Week and Easter. Please make a note also, the final of our midweek Lenten devotions will be this Wednesday. The subject, the art of living by faith, and our topic will be about prayer. That'll be posted by 6 p.m. on Wednesday, as long as all the technology works, of course. Then your plans already for Holy Week. A reminder that we will have services on campus on Thursday and Friday evening for Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday. Those will be at 6 p.m. And of course, Easter Sunday services are at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. We'd love to see you on Easter. We do ask, please, right away, contact the church office and reserve your place so we can make the best use of our sanctuary as we look forward to being together for the festival of Easter. Two other simple things of preparation for Palm Sunday, especially if you'll be remaining home. We did send a pattern out to you. We could send it again if you'd like to ask us for that. So you could make some palm branches for your home to wave them. That's for children of all ages, to wave that during our prelude for Palm Sunday next week. And also for the Good Friday Tenebrae, we're going to ask you to dim candles and lights in your home as we do here at church. So start looking, if you will, for the seven candles, six similar candles for the readings, and then the Christ candle as well. I'll give you time to start looking for those. I'll mention them again next week. That's enough words of instruction for us. I do hope you'll get outside and enjoy some fresh air and sunshine. Let's have our dismissal now. Please stand. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. We wish you a very blessed week.